Today is August 23rd, 2004. My name is Rosalind Benjet, and I'll be talking today with Arnold Sweet at his home at 10810 Branch Oak Circle in Dallas. Our videographer is Ruth Andrus. Arnie, tell us about your family. Where did they come from and how did they get to Dallas?
My mother lived in Russia, near Kiev, and my father was born in the United States, actually in Chicago. My mother's family came really one at a time. She had an older brother, Meyer, who was in business in the old country, and Meyer was able to
stop. Today is August 23rd, 2004. My name is Rosalind Benjet, and we are here talking today with Arnold Sweet at his home at 10810 Branch Oak Circle in Dallas. Our videographer is Ruth Andrus. Arnie, tell us about your family. Where did they come from, and how did they get to Dallas?
My mother's family was brought up in the little town of Cherkinow, and so in Russia. And there was an older brother and three sisters, and my grandfather and my grandmother. My uncle, Meyer, was able to, over a period of years, earn enough money to bring the rest of the family to the United States. The reason for the United States, I think, is the reason for so many. It was the land of bread and honey, and the place that you would like to be. And he was successful bringing his father and my mother and my aunts. My dad was actually born in Chicago. Dallas was starting to mature into a real city, and they somehow saw some opportunity there. And settled in Houston and Dallas, mostly in Houston.
Approximately when do you think they arrived in Texas? Have any idea?
It would be some 80 years ago.
Mm-hmm. So they first went to Houston?
Somewhat Houston. Most of them actually went to Houston, and actually mother was here because that's where Dad happened to settle. He and Dad and his brother, and then in Minneapolis, had a little hat manufacturing company. Then it went into caps, sportswear, and they did well in Minneapolis, so they opened up a little store here in Dallas, and that was where I got my dad here, and mother was here on a visit, and they saw each other a few times and fell in love. Mm-hmm. They lived until my dad died in 88.
And did they continue in the hat business?
Yes, they did. It actually followed trends for a while. everyone wore a cap. Adapted that way, and so it was Sweet Cap Company. And then hats came into vogue, and so it was Sweet Hat and Cap Company. And then so they really were looking for something else, went into ties, and ties into sports shirts. Just kind of kept up with what was needed. Even doing some supplying in World War II of uniforms.
Mm-hmm. And where was their business located?
The business was located on Commerce Street, Dallas, which housed a lot of small businesses and businesses whose families emanated from very similar circumstances to my folks. Mm-hmm. It became the garment area. It was Aaron Brothers Clothing and another, the Jenicoves had pants, slacks, and it became kind of a little New York. It happened to be located directly across from the Chamber of Commerce.
Mm-hmm. And so you were born in Dallas?
Born in Dallas. Mm-hmm. Never have left Dallas.
Mm-hmm.
Spent 6 years at the University of Texas, but never really left this as a home.
Mm-hmm. And where did you live when you were a child?
I was born in South Dallas, which is where the Jewish community came from. I was only there a little over a year, and we moved over to Lakewood. A little unusual because there was not a heavy Jewish population there. They had like the Lakewood location because it had an empty lot, so there was a lot of space. And mm-hmm. gave us a chance to have a football playground.
Did you have brothers and sisters?
I have one brother.
Mm-hmm.
His name's Harold. 4 years older than me. And Harold continues to this day the same business that my dad started.
Mm-hmm. Different location.
The location was taken over by the government for an office building, and all of those little merchants and manufacturers left their area to make room for the federal building that was actually built right where my dad's premises had been.
Now, where did you go to school then when you were a child, in Lakewood?
went to William Lipscomb, which was a grammar school. The usual water fountains, one for blacks and one for whites. And went through grammar school there, and went to junior high, living in the same area. And then just before I entered high school, we moved near Highland Park.
Mm-hmm.
Not exactly Highland Park or exactly University Park, but in that area. And I went to Long Junior High. And from there to Highland Park, where I graduated high school.
Mm-hmm. Did your family belong to a synagogue?
Yes. They were members of Sherith Israel and were in Sherith in its very earliest location and its next location on Pocahontas in South Dallas.
Mm-hmm.
And then over to where it presently exists on mm-hmm. Douglas Street in Dallas.
And how did your family celebrate Jewish holidays?
We did some of the traditional things. Couldn't call us a very, wouldn't call us observant. We recognized the holidays. We knew Shabbat was different than the other days of the week. We didn't go to many of the services, such as Shavuos and Purim and many of the other things. We always had a beautiful celebration at Passover. Always had all the family over for the Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur holidays. But the religious life of our family was fairly limited.
Mm-hmm. And did you attend Hebrew school or Sunday school?
I attended Sunday school. Unfortunately, where we lived out in Lakewood, we could never convince the bus to go that far out of the way. They had a route and we weren't on it. So my Hebrew had to come from Sunday school, which wasn't much, and I was tutored for my bar mitzvah by a rabbi in South Dallas.
Mm-hmm. And were you a participant then in any Jewish groups as a teenager?
As a teenager, I was active in two main groups, Young Judea and BBYO, mm-hmm. Young Judea being more serious, more observant, centered around Judaism, whereas AJA and BBG, which is BBYO, was more social-minded, mm-hmm. but did very good things in the community, and really probably, I think, was the most important force in bringing Jewish kids together.
Mm-hmm. What kind of activities did they have then?
Oh, we had a group of kids, for instance, out near Harry Hines, where we coached them in playing softball. These kids are maybe 8, 9 years mm-hmm. old. We did some work for the homeless. Visited them. Not to the extent that it would have been nice and could have been to a greater extent, but enough to know that we were very fortunate. Not everybody didn't live in the kind of homes that we live in, and it was a good social conscience upbringing.
Mm-hmm. And you said that when you went to college, you went to
the University of Texas in Austin. Mm-hmm. Spent 6 years there, got a Bachelor of Business and Law degree mm-hmm. In Texas, and came from there to my first job, which was as an assistant district attorney, and did that for about a year, and then went into private legal practice.
Mm-hmm. And what kind of law did you specialize in?
My specialty was whatever walked in the door. That's from criminal, civil, to mediation. Mm-hmm. Just about anything you could somehow connect to being of a legal nature, then mm-hmm. that was my specialty.
And if you were to look back over cases that you've had, what would be some that you found really memorable?
We had a case of malicious prosecution And this is, the charge is that the defendant in running his business, kept a very sharp eye on his employees. And one particular employee he turned in for theft. And I was always convinced that she didn't do it, and really went through every, I guess, malicious prosecution case there was to be found, and went to court with it and lost. So she had to serve a little jail time. Hopefully I was able to get her a lighter sentence than she would have gotten otherwise.
And then how did you and Janice meet?
Blind day. A young man named Charlie Ross said, "Hey Arnie, there's someone you need to meet. His name is Janice Sally." And he says, "I was not known for good directions. I had this reputation for always going the wrong way." He says, "So the only problem you're going to have is finding her." Because she lived out beyond White Rock Lake, and in an area that just didn't jump out at you. You had to know where you were going. So anyway, I think probably about 45 minutes late on the first day, located her, and we went together for about a year and a half, got engaged, and Janice was a bride at 18.
And when were you married then?
September 7th, 1957.
Oh, how nice, a man who remembers.
September 15th, 1957. Yeah, correct that.
Okay. What was Dallas like in the late 50s or early 60s?
You know, it's kind of, it's harder to see it from an adult perspective and a kid's perspective, but it was a conservative little town, from what I can always remember. It was a pretty segregated town time. Those were the years though when things started to happen, and we started getting people like the Kennedys in office and Martin Luther King. And we kind of grew slowly out of our racial hatred situation, which of course exists still to some extent today.
Sure. Was there much Jewish involvement in the civil rights movement then?
There wasn't much in numbers, but we had some very powerful people that had a very good influence on the community and were recognized as Jews. And I feel as though we should have had a lot more. We should have devoted more time to teaching our people how far behind we were, but little by little we've gotten to the point where we now have black judges, we now have a black mayor, black congress people. Those are the kinds of things we didn't have that early.
Mm-hmm. And you've talked about the movement of the Jewish community from South Dallas to North Dallas. How do you think that affected Jewish life in the city then, at that point?
Well, it was a big change. the Jewish people, for the most part, were successful, either with good jobs, secure jobs, or in their own business, and started wanting to find another area of town to improve their physical situation.
Mm-hmm.
And so there was a movement from South Dallas to North Dallas, and put like a few little detours in between, but basically that was it.
Mm-hmm.
And most of the Jewish population did end up in the Highland University Park and those areas.
Mm-hmm. And you've been involved in both Jewish and civic organizations as an adult.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell us a little about your involvement in, well, let's start with civic affairs.
Well, I served on a couple of boards and commissions.
Mm-hmm.
I chaired one that Dave Anders didn't like. That was the Board of Adjustment for Science, and there was a lot of complaints that their Dallas was getting too cluttered with signs, both in size and number, and so this kind of new department was created, and Jack Evans, who was the mayor at the time, asked me if I would serve, and then I later chaired the Sign Control Board. And Dave, and just using him as an example, said little people ought to be able to put their signs up and advertise, and they shouldn't have to get anyone's permission. And so he didn't like that. A lot of people didn't. It was not a very effective tool, as you can see. We got every kind of sign there is, or anything to draw your attention away from the street and the highway and the driving. But it was a lot of work, and it was plowing through some new territory.
Mm-hmm.
Served on another board or two. Not really, not great consequence. Received the Brotherhood Award, and got that as a result of going around and speaking to some of the schools, say within 100 miles of Dallas.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like Sulphur Springs, and Gainesville, and numerous places like that, and there was always a Protestant participant who would do this as panels,
mm-hmm.
and a Catholic, and a Jew. Even though we were talking about racial matters, it didn't consist of a black person. And we would go to their assemblies and speak as to morals and ethics and those kinds of things. And it was rather two-faced, because the difference in going to the high school and going to the white high school and the black high school were like night and day. Each community was set up pretty much that way.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like preparing for two totally different speeches, two totally different audiences. And it was good work. Unfortunately, the Brotherhood Award, that it was known for many, many years throughout the country, is either no longer active anywhere, or it's not active anymore in Dallas.
And then you have an enormous list of involvement in Jewish organizations. Right. How did you get started, and what did you do?
Well, I think I said last time I started working Federation cars off my Cushman motor scooter. And I had my little stack of cars and take off on my little Cushman and built up a few accounts. I go back to them every year, get a few pennies more. And I liked it. I felt that it was really good stuff, and I was coming around to my Jewishness, which I can't even tell you exactly where it came from. Maybe a grandfather's or someone down in that family. And I started went into both Young Judea and BBYO, and then founded one of the AZA chapters called Henry Monsky. Mm-hmm. Did that along with Sid Stahl. And then I guess from there, I was interested in the synagogue to some degree, continuing with BBYO. And then the rest of it, it just seems to come. If you're doing it, it adds up. And the busier you are, the more you can do. Mm-hmm. And so it grew into my, I guess what you call it, an avocation.
Mm-hmm. And who were your mentors as you were developing into a community leader?
People like Earl Donsky, Stanley Pearl, Murray Mundus, many, many, many other local, Jake Feldman. And then I would say that my thinking of it was shaped a lot by some great speakers and rabbis like Harold Schulweis, and one that turned out to be a very dear friend of ours, Yitz Greenberg, and his wife Blue, who's also a scholar. And one of the most powerful people I ever encountered was David Hartman. He's a rabbi and philosopher living in Israel, made Aliyah to Israel from Canada. And there was another rabbi by the name of Herb Friedman, and he took a group of us through the concentration camps and left an indelible impression.
Mm-hmm. Now, you've mentioned working for Federation. What other organizations have you been involved with?
So I was a vice president of the synagogue for a short while, and active in the American Jewish Committee. Still serving on the boards of the Holocaust Center, and recently on the board of Legacy, the new home for Jewish. We won't call it the new Home for Jewish Age, because the Home for Jewish Age is still there and will remain there. But the Legacy, of course, is going to be a whole
different concept.
A whole onset, mm-hmm. the whole life mm-hmm. cycle, of the elderly life cycle.
Mm-hmm. And you've also been interested in projects relating to Israel.
Right, and that's probably, or is, JCRC, Jewish Community Relations Council. Mm-hmm. But Israel was probably the mainstay of our home. It was part of our home. It was part of our Friday night Shabbat. We always always had an inclination toward Israel, and then it started permeating our little family, and was the moving force to get us to go kosher, and keeping up with these people like Yitz, reading about Leonard Fan, another great Jewish author, also a friend. But most of our time is dedicated to Jewish affairs, mm-hmm. both here and in Israel.
Right. And I know you have three daughters.
Right. And the oldest made Aliyah about 27 years ago, 26, 27 years ago. Lives on a kibbutz down in the Negev Desert. Large producers of dates, and they have fish farms, and do some very interesting things, and that's her life, and she's got four children. We get there as often as we can. If we don't get there, then they'll get here, so that we see each other at least every year. Mm-hmm. We're very close to the situation. The first thing we look at in the newspaper is what's happened to Israel, who's doing it to Israel today, and in what form. And trying diligently to keep up with that situation.
Mm-hmm. And your other two daughters?
And other two daughters. The next is Cindy, our middle daughter. Cindy was just elected president of her shul. She and her husband and a group of about 10 other couples formed a new shul. It's been now almost 6 years they've been in existence, out in Plano. Mm-hmm. And then our youngest child is likewise very, very involved Jewishly. Same new synagogue.
Which is, the name is?
The name is Anshei Torah. Mm-hmm. And she's going to co-chair the housing division for the Maccabi games that are coming up. So it'll be a very big job.
Yes. And you've gone on many missions to Israel.
I tie in our personal missions and our missions, I guess, were mm-hmm. 18, 20.
Mm-hmm. For a while, it was every 2 years. Mm-hmm.
And any of them memorable in some way?
Everyone was memorable in some distinct way. I guess my most poignant one was being there just a few days after the Yom Kippur War. And this is where they were still burying soldiers in temporary graves and starting to put them into proper surroundings. And that was really an indication of how the country could be devastated, how far someone was able to go in pulling a surprise attack. Mm-hmm. Then I guess our mission, Janice and I led in 1974, was probably the penultimate. We got to kind of group together, about 40 of us, studied for 6 months, and went over to Israel and had a real study mission. And with people like Adin Steinsaltz, who is someone that's been mentioned to take the Rebbe's position possibly. And I had mentioned David Hartman before. It was the beginning of major growth for a lot of women in the community. We met with Rabin, Yitzhak Rabin. We met many times with Prime Minister Yitzhak Rabin. Said Shimon Peres. And several times with Sharon. Mm-hmm. Watched him get bigger.
I think he's still doing that.
Mm-hmm.
Are you currently studying?
Yeah, not as much as I should be. Janice is ahead of me right now on that. But yes, I am, and intend to study from now on.
Mm-hmm. What are you most proud of in all the different things that you've done?
I think just taking part in a family that is made up of really good people. Mm-hmm. My daughters and sons-in-law are just really remarkably fine people. And whatever role I played in that, I guess it's the thing I've been most proud of.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Is there anything that you would like to add before we finish? You can add.
Well, I think a couple things.
I'd like to sit next to him. You can get both of them.
When he was younger, he became active in forming Henry Monsky ACA, and he became very active, and even into his freshman year in college. And in college, he was very had a lot of leadership roles. He was Chief Justice,
Chief Justice
Supreme of the Supreme Court, President of his chapter. And you want to talk a little bit about that?
Oh, she's
good.
It's good.
You can
ask. It's good.
In years past, when they needed someone to speak to raise funds, American Jewish Committee and ADL and lots of things like that, they'd always ask Arnie to get everybody fired up and write a check.
Mm-hmm. Yes, the other thing
exciting.
I didn't mention was politics. I do love politics.
Mm-hmm.
Mostly because of Israel and support people who support Israel. But I do think it's really, really critical things if we get Jewish people into politics.
Mm-hmm. Those were the days. So we had Mondale here. And
City Dukakis.
Dukakis here. And lots. That was a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you very much.